Retro.
Hi, this is Vanessa Marshall, voice of Hera and Rook Cast, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continually unexpected.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Welcome to Podcast Stardust. This is the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. I'm Dennis Heathley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And it's a new week, and that means it's time to talk some Rebels. But before we get into Rebels, Jay can remind everybody where we can be found around the internet.
You got it, Dennis. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram, conveniently at Podcast Stardust.
Okay, the disc is aligned, the signal's boosted to maximum output, the shield is down, and we are now broadcasting to the galaxy. So we are down to three, I think, episodes left. And when this one debuted, it was actually premiered with the episode that comes after this, which is called World Between Worlds. But we're going to tackle them one at a time. So we're just going to do Wolves in a Door, which is episode 12 of season 4 of Rebels. With all of that preamble out of the way, Jay, you want to go ahead and give us the summary of the episode?
Yes, and I've been so excited to talk about this with you. After receiving the tablet with the strange markings on it from the Loth-wolves, Ezra, Hera, Sabine, Zeb, and Chopper agree to defend the Jedi Temple on Lothal from the Empire. With the assistance of the Loth-wolves, they make their way back north. Once there, they find the Empire has dismantled the temple. Disguised as scout troopers, Ezra and Sabine sneak in for a closer look. They discover the Emperor himself is interested in a gateway. And while Sabine distracts the Imperial soldiers, Ezra activates a mysterious gateway to an unknown location and enters.
Mm-hmm. This is where, and I guess it technically started at the end of the last episode with the Loth-wolves presenting Ezra with this stone tablet that had these markings on it. But it really, in this episode, gets amped up to something really different going on here. Something very unexpected. As a conclusion for this series, what did you think about this episode overall?
Oh my gosh, I'm so glad. I say this every week when we do this. I'm so glad we're revisiting these, but I really am. And this just gets into the heart and soul of some of the mysticism of the Force, all the different layers of the Force. And, you know, it's bringing in Clone Wars stuff with this as well. And it's just, it's got such, you know, you talk about Indiana Jones just coming out recently. It's definitely got an indie feel to it with the music and, you know, just the way that everything goes about this. But it's such a great episode in that it just dives right into the faith of the Force, you know, and just trusting in your instincts and trusting in what needs to be done, whether that was even Hera, you know, trusting the wolves, you know, and just trusting in what needed to be done.
Yeah, definitely so. And you're right. The Indiana Jones influence is keenly felt when they're looking at where the temple used to be. And then there's all of these Imperials there and they've got tables and they've been dismantling the thing. And there's even some musical cues that sound like they're straight out of Raiders of the Lost Ark. And so, yeah, it's a good point. The timing of this episode with Dial Destiny coming up at the end of the month is worked out really well for us. So there is that there. It's kind of a nice rebound for the Rebels as well, because when we were talking about the prior episode, Doom, we both remarked about how melancholy it was and how we kind of got choked up watching that because we were watching everyone try to get a handle on their grief after Kanan passed away. And this episode touches on that just a little bit. But it is really the Rebels doing what they do best, which is coming up with a plan of action and they go do it. So that was kind of nice to see a rebound for these guys.
For sure.
So they all agree that they got to do something about this Jedi temple that the Empire is investigating, and they agree they can't let it fall into their hands. The problem is, how did they get there? Because they're in the Southern Hemisphere and the temple is back in the North. So this is when Ezra kind of summons the Loth-wolves. So we got the White Loth-wolf, not Doom, not the big one, and then a couple of the other smaller ones. And I love this. You know, Ezra is so confident. He just climbs right up on the back of that White Loth-wolf, and Hera follows his lead. Zeb's a little nervous at first, but then kind of plays it off and gets on one. And then, you know, Chopper is just kind of there squawking. So the Loth-wolf next to him just picks him up with his mouth. Yes. And then they start running off. And as they go through the fields, they start sinking into the ground. And then once again, we get that hyperspace effect, like they are running through some sort of a hyperspace tunnel. What did you think about their voyage back north? I mean, it's not exactly new because we dealt with this when they came south, but you know, what stood out to you, the return?
It kind of put a little bit more clarity on what the Loth-wolves could do, you know, in terms of what their place is in the forest, what their duties are in the forest, I guess you could say. You know, they're almost the stewards of those that need their help to, you know, utilize what they need to get through Lothal. And this is the first instance that I was mentioning of trust that we see. You know, Ezra had to trust that the Loth-wolves would do what he asked them to do. And then Zeb had to trust the wolves, which was so funny. He was talking to the one and Ezra's like, those don't talk.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, you don't know that. So he was just,
it talks with its eyes.
It talks with its eyes. Exactly. And even Sabine, you know, just kind of petting the wolf and, you know, just getting into the trust aspect of things.
So we are now returning to our regularly scheduled program after having had to take a break for some safety issues due to weather. Jay, we can't win. Pulling back the curtain here, how many Thursdays have we had in the recent months where one of the two of us has been under some sort of severe thunderstorm warning? We've had to push back recording. And in the middle of this discussion, or not even in the middle of the discussion, you had to go seek shelter due to a tornado warning. So we're going to pick this back up.
Oh, my gosh.
I can't exactly remember where we left off. We've been talking about the Loth-wolves. So I apologize if we're repeating ourselves to our listeners here, but we did talk a bit about how, you know, they sank into the ground as they were running. We had the hyperspace tunnel, and
That's I think where we were,
right? And so, you know, we do know they're connected with the Force. If you watch the Rebels recon, they cover both this episode and the next episode of War Between Worlds, which we were talking about as well. And we get, you know, more details about how, you know, these are Force beings. They're connected to the Force, and so there's that. And then the Rebels have to take the rest of the way on foot in order to get to the temple. And as you had said a moment ago, there's some serious Indiana Jones vibes going on here with the way that everything is being laid out. And it's kind of like the Nazis looking for the Ark in Raiders of the Lost Ark, except for now they're dismantling the temple, trying to discover the secrets for Palpatine. So what did you make of all that? What stood out to you there?
Well, again, you know, I think we had also discussed the idea of trust, you know, and the trusting in the wolves and then trusting in the process to get them there. And then at this point, when they're kind of overlooking everything that was going on, and then when Sabine and Ezra decide that they're going to be the ones that are going to go undercover and they're going to do the whole scout trooper thing. And then they get to a point where they weren't sure if they should go on with it. And then again, that's where the idea of trust comes in, because Kanan's ghost appears and kind of lays his hand on Hera's shoulder, and she just reaches up and caresses it and just kind of holds it to her shoulder. And that was the deciding moment that, okay, we're going to go in here. But very cool in terms of the visualization is concerned, just the almost desperation that you could tell was going on with trying to get into this temple. And but it was a very different type of operation, and they even said that, and I can't remember the exact word that they used. They said this isn't a such and such operation, and they were able to figure that out right away. Did you catch what word they were talking about?
No, I sure didn't. But, you know, one of the things you talk about there is, you know, that Force presence of Kanan there. And, it, you know, it's no one could see him. You know, this was, it was, I believe he was there present in the Force with Hera, because she certainly did draw some comfort and some strength from that. But it's, Zeb's reaction was he was just watching her and didn't seem to notice anything about a cane or whatever. But the, getting back to this whole Force presences, as they were going through hyperspace, we had all of these different characters showing up. They were kind of seeing these visions and hearing these voices, and it was from earlier episodes in the series, and it was different people talking about the Force and things that were going on, and how, we had several lines from Kanan, including about how things were, starting to come into focus or into shape, but, something's about to happen, and some lines from Ahsoka there as well, and even the Inquisitor. There was the lines from Kanan when the Inquisitor had said something like, someone else has died because of you, and then his response is like, nope. Yeah, that was a mistake because I have nothing left to lose. Right. And so there was a lot of Kanan that came up there. And then when they got through, they were asking each other, the rebels were asking each other, it's like, did you hear that? What was going on? And Ezra, who was probably the only one that could properly interpret that, was off with the Loth-wolf at the time.
That's so true. Yeah, it's kind of almost like an otherworldly experience for all of them.
Right. And I absolutely loved that when those two scout troopers left the excavation site, Chopper used a hologram of Thrawn from the zero-hour episode, basically telling Hera that, I'm not going to accept any surrenders, Captain Syndulla. And then that, Zeb came up and clonked him over the head. So that was a nice little touch.
Yeah, for sure.
So, when they get into this excavation, we're going to kind of take some events out of order here. The Emperor makes an appearance here. And he's got a keen interest in this temple, and he's familiar with the iconography that's going on, because the counselor that is there, voiced by Malcolm McDowell, and the character's name is Mr. Hydan, is talking about these Mortis gods that are there. And Palpatine even calls them Mortis gods. What did you think about that? Not just calling them like Force entities or whatever, but called them Mortis gods.
Oh, yeah. He had the name and everything for them. And in Rebels Recon, they talked about how, perhaps Palpatine was kind of a curator of Sith artifacts and that kind of thing. But Mortis really wasn't really in any specific category as far as, Sith or Jedi or whatever. It was kind of an entity unto itself. But because of what we've gotten since then, especially in The Rise of Skywalker, the line that he refers to as a conduit between the living and the dead really caught my attention, because I'm thinking, oh, okay. Like, now in hindsight, looking back into this, could this have been some of the beginning steps of Palpatine's search for his immortality, so to speak, or, everything that he was doing with the cloning process and that type of thing, which I know at the time was not part of this, but you can kind of look back and see how that kind of fits, which is super cool.
Yeah, it really is. And the other thing about it is, the only place he could have, well, that's not true. The only place that we've seen on screen that he could have learned about Mortis was from Anakin. When he was there, in those, that trilogy of episodes that we had during, from the Clone Wars, where he, Obi-Wan, and Ahsoka ended up in this, Mortis realm or whatever we want to call it. And then they escaped. But that's the connection he's got. His apprentice was there at Mortis with the three, the father, the son, and the daughter, and brought that knowledge back. And so, even then, though, that doesn't completely explain how he would know about this realm, like World Between Worlds, that we're going to find out in the next episode that's coming up after this one. So confession, I am not the biggest fan of the Mortis arc. I've never hidden that. And you and I have talked about that in the past. It's it's a trilogy of episodes I've never really been able to wrap my mind around completely. I don't dislike them. I'm just not as in awe of them. However, things like this, where Palpatine is so interested in it and he's got some details about it there that, to your point, he's making connections between them and this realm and what that might be. He's got a very clear idea of what this might mean and what he can do with it.
Right, right. And, you know, and I'm wondering, too, like you said, where did he learn from about this? Mm-hmm. Was it from Plagueis? And was this something that was perhaps passed down? Or was it in some sort of, you know, ancient Sith texts, like the ancient Jedi texts kind of thing? And it also kind of makes me wonder, when I was rewatching this, about how the mythology and ideology of the Mortis gods fits into the kind of the history of the Jedi and the Sith as a whole. And, you know, I know that you're not the biggest fan of it, but it would kind of be cool to see or hear this being addressed even in the new High Republic material, to kind of bring some of that full circle and to know if there was any talk of this back then, mm-hmm. or any knowledge of it back then, you know, and even the idea of the world between worlds that could have been lost. Because as we've seen through some of the other things that we've gotten in the High Republic, there were things that were known at the time that the Jedi of this age, you know, we're talking, you know, original trilogy, prequel trilogy, did not know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so. That's true. And we've also discovered there's other things the Jedi knew at one point and then didn't seem to pass on. Or
that's
was
what
not
I'm saying. So, yes.
Yeah. Yeah. That they didn't think to tell the future generations about. It was just not important for whatever reason. So exactly. that is an interesting observation there. I kept wanting to see if this, like, Minister Hydan was someone that we'd heard of before, but doesn't look like it. It was a new character. They originally were going to have him be Vane, which was that minister that attended mm-hmm. to Vader on Mustafar, but they decided mm-hmm. to go with someone different there who looked just as creepy.
Yeah. Well, I wonder if he ends up being one of the acolytes even for, you know, in concept, he could mm-hmm. be one of the acolytes that was there, you know, with Palpatine.
Yeah, very fussy, dude, because he was mm-hmm. like all over anybody that was touching the artifacts, and he's mm-hmm. you know, one smudge can change everything. And
right.
So we now know that Palpatine is really interested in this temple, and Ezra and Sabine have infiltrated everything, and they're looking around. They're disguised as their scout troopers. They are nearly avoiding capture. At one time, Ezra uses a mind trick on a death trooper to get him to leave him alone. And then we get to see the painting of the father, the son, and the daughter there. And Sabine had taken a holo image of that tablet that the wolves had brought to Ezra. And we had the three Hamba symbols, kind of the back of a hand, then the upraised palm and by the father, and then the fist by the son. And it takes him a moment, and it takes Sabine creating quite a distraction to lead off the stormtroopers for him to put two and two together and concentrate on this to get this all to work. And when he does, that whole painting like shifts, comes to life, things fall into place. And then the wolves that are in the painting wander off and create this portal. So, you know, talk about that a little bit. You know, what did you think? What was your response to that?
I was so excited, you know, just seeing the Mortis gods on the wall. And just, I love the line that Sabine says when Ezra asks her, well, what, I don't know what any of this means. Does it mean anything? And Sabine said, it's art. It always means something. And I just think that speaks volumes, you know, of course, Sabine the artist, but yet it's so prophetic, you know, in mm-hmm. a lot of ways too. But again, this is just another example of the trust factor that had to happen so that when, you know, even Ezra said, but I can't open this by myself. Kanan always said it needed a master and apprentice. And Sabine's trying to, you know, of course, encourage him. And then finally he finds it within himself to get this to happen. But I really, really love the whole visualization of the 2D art and the 3D art combining mm-hmm. to create this whole visualization template. And just, it's so super cool.
Yeah, a couple things that you said I want to respond to there. The confidence that Ezra gains, and he kind of realizes that Kanan may be dead, but he's still with him mm-hmm. there. That his training is going to live on in Ezra, and that Kanan's influence will guide him for the rest of his life, the rest of his journey as a Jedi. And therefore, he's able to do this. He's able to open things, and he takes that deep breath, and he thinks about Kanan's teachings, and he makes it happen, which is really cool. And then I just loved how I didn't even notice the presence of the wolves the majority of the time that we're looking at that image until they come to life. Mm-hmm. Until, you know, all of a sudden they're looking sideways at the father, the son, and the daughter, and then they turn and they look at Ezra, and then they lead him away from that image and start running in that ring pattern. And yeah, it just keeps adding to their importance and the mystique about these creatures in the Force in a way that just keeps building. And we still don't have all the answers about them. And I love that, that it is so open for interpretation.
Oh, I agree. And, you know, and it kind of makes me sad in a way that, you know, the Loth-wolves were never utilized again beyond Rebels, because I feel like there's so much untapped goodness that could have been, you know, coming out of this. And maybe we'll see it in the Ahsoka series, because we know we're going back to Lothal. So it'd be amazing if we could, because I was really hoping, this is kind of an aside, that the little kyber foxes, what are they called? You know what I'm talking about, in The Last Jedi, those little crystal foxes.
Crystal foxes, you know, from
the Vulptex, that's what they were called, that they never really, you know, did anything with them either. So I just think there's so much untapped potential there, but the wolves are so incredibly cool.
Yeah, Dave Filoni loves his wolves.
Oh, yeah.
He made these ones really, really special. Mm-hmm. And that, it's kind of hard to talk about this episode without getting into the next one, but I don't want to get into that discussion without having watched that episode again and then really diving into the details there. But you also brought up the whole two-dimensional art being melded with the three-dimensional art for when the portrait came to life. And it was cool listening to them on Rebels Recon talk about how they brought in another studio to make that happen, and how it was a challenge to blend it and make it look seamless. Mm-hmm. But you're right, it was a really, really well done segment that was completely believable. But it's kind of like, if you go see the Spider-Man movies, Into the Spider-Verse or Across the Spider-Verse, you get those two different, those conflicting art styles that show up in those movies. And that's what happened here. Mm-hmm. But they still just made it work really beautifully.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, it was the perfect way to tell the story and to literally bring it to life.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so that's where we are at the end of this one. The portal's been created. And as the stormtroopers and Minister Hydan are closing in, Ezra jumps through the portal and the stormtroopers go running after him and then run smack dab into the rock. Yeah. So the portal essentially closes right behind him. And we'll find out more about where Ezra is in the next episode. But you know, we've reached the end. Do you have any other thoughts on this one before we wrap it up?
Well, just that look on Minister Hyden's face when Ezra goes through, he realizes that Ezra had gone through. And then when those stormtroopers hit the wall, you could see there was a mix of both like awe and like excitement, and also like, what just happened, you know?
Yeah.
So I just, yeah, that was super cool. And then to see that visualization of Ezra's helmet just kind of teetering there on the ground, you know, is the last image we see.
Yeah. And now we have to wait a week before we can talk about the next episode, which is just really mind-blowing. Some really big things that happened there. So just before we wrap this up, I wanted to thank all of our listeners for sticking with us. I know this was a bit more disjointed than our usual Rebels conversation, but what can we say? We had to deal with, we had to be safe, and we had to get this one done, and that was our priority here. So yeah, thank you for indulging us. And if we repeated ourselves, well, then you know, thanks for putting up with that. And we have lots of great things to say about the next episode of Rebels, which we'll be getting to next week. But
and hopefully no storms.
Yeah, something about us recording on Thursday, we put up with this a lot, and you were telling me offline, we have to switch to Wednesdays because that's
something.
We seem to have better luck with that. And I mean, I got thunder going on the background here as we're
recording. Yeah, I got another one brewing too, so it's crazy.
All right. Well, then, thank you for joining us for episode 587 of Podcast Artists on our discussion of Wolves in a Door, the 12th episode of season 4 of Rebels. We hope you've enjoyed it. And if so, please hit that subscribe button on your podcatcher for Podcast Artists. And if you want to find some way back episodes of the show, then head over to RetroZap.com, where all 586 previous episodes can be located. And while you're there, you can also discover some other great podcasts covering other great geek topics, such as the MCU, DC, Dune, Star Trek, collecting, and a whole lot more. As always, we greatly appreciate your 5-star ratings and reviews on whatever podcatcher it is that you use, especially if that's Apple Podcasts. And please don't forget to share the show and your favorite episodes on social media with your friends. So, speaking of that, Jay, can remind everybody what those social media contacts are one more time.
Absolutely. We are found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we do have a Pinterest page with all kinds of boards to check out. And our YouTube channel, which has all of our past episodes, as well as some fun unboxing videos. So head over there, like, and subscribe. And if you're up for some real-time chatter, you can find a room over on the RetroZap Discord server dedicated just to Podcast Stardust. And there's also bunches of other dedicated rooms as well. As Dennis mentioned, lots of other geekery properties over there. So chances are you'll find possibly one or more things to have fun talking about. So if you want to get involved in that, just go to our show page, click on our community tab, and you are there. And if you are in need of some new home goods or some new apparel, we do have Podcast Stardust logos over on TeePublic, 7 of them to be exact. And you can find them on everything from t-shirts, sweatshirts, coffee mugs, all kinds of home goods, apparel, swag, you name it, it's probably over there. And again, that's tpublic.com/user/podcaststardust. So with that, Dennis, why don't you update everybody on what else you have going on in the podcast world between worlds?
That's your fashion lifestyle product. So with the return of Star Trek Strange New Worlds, my wife and I will be firing up Warp Trails, which is our podcast devoted to all things Star Trek, and you can find those episodes exclusively on the RetroZap podcast feed. So if you don't know what that means, just head to your podcatcher, look for RetroZap, and then you'll find all episodes of all shows that are part of the RetroZap podcast network, and that would include all episodes of Warp Trail. So we're excited to talk about the season premiere, so be looking for that if it hasn't already hit your feed. Jay, what is the latest in cosplay?
All right, well, right now on my Instagram, which is at j.snipscosplay, you can catch all kinds of fun things going on. Mainly right now, I'm doing a lot of Hera. So we've been talking about Rebels, and I've been living Rebels. And also Ahsoka from the Clone Wars and the Fourth Sister Inquisitor, Leia from Return of the Jedi. And I'm working on 2 new builds this summer. I've got my Hera upgraded for the Ahsoka series, as well as an original concept Mandalorian that I'm working on, and helping Qui-Gon finish up his 5th brother Inquisitor. So we've got dates in mind and all kinds of deadlines and stuff going on. So we're really working hard this summer on those. So again, that's at j.snipscosplay.
All right. Upcoming on the show this Wednesday, we have our Return of the Jedi Part 6 episode with a couple great guests. And then on Friday, we'll be getting back into some Star Wars news. So with that, thanks for listening to episode 587 of Podcast Stardust. Have a great week. And until next time, may the Force be with you.